Classical era. We call it all classical music, but actually, classical was actually a specific era within this, what we call serious music, or whatever you want to call it, classical era. And now they're really starting to get into larger orchestras, as opposed to in the Baroque, where a lot of it was more intimate, what they called chamber music and that sort of thing. And now instrumental music really began to dominate over the vocal. Vocal became less and less common. It was really more instruments came into their own. The church was no longer the primary venue. During the Baroque, it was both church and kings and counts and barons and stuff. But now it really started to become the concert hall. And this is where I say the solidification of forms. Whenever you have the academy getting involved in art, that can be a problematic thing, because then who is the composer composing for? With arts, always look to who the patron is, who's the patron. And in this case, who are they trying to please, in other words? And they're trying to now please other musicians and other music critics and that sort of thing, as opposed to necessarily the public. That's what you start to see here. And they really became obsessed with forms. Remember, I showed you in the with the Gregorian chant, like AABA form and that sort of thing. But now they had like symphonic form and concerto form and sonata form and all this kind of stuff. And it really, if there was ever a time that you could say that the subjective started to outweigh just natural music making, this would have been it, where these human-made forms, because a symphony is not something that just came about by itself. It was, in a sense, a subjective form, and so was the sonata and so forth. So, but I'll just play you some of these, because there was great music here, but I think this is where a lot of people get bored with classical music, is in this period, because they don't understand these. Some of these were very large forms. It's more interesting if you understand symphonic form or if you understand sonata form. But if you don't, it can get very boring, okay? But, and I didn't mean to bring up Mozart while I was saying boring.
No, to be fair, some of his stuff, yes. He wrote a lot.
He did. He was considered one of the greatest geniuses of all time. This is one of my favorite symphony. Is it 40? Right, 40 symphony. Little bit of the first movement. I'm not going to play these for very long. Keep moving on here. Schubert, who wrote Schubert's Ave Maria. This is, again, one of my favorites. This is his fifth opening. This is the opening movement of his fifth symphony. Beethoven was technically part of the classical era, but he really was the first of the romantic composers, even though chronologically he fell within the classical era. And you can immediately hear, this is just...
Isn't Schubert considered somewhat...
Yeah, I would say so, late classical, yep. But Beethoven really was the one who started to push the limits of it. and I'll show some examples later. But
what do you mean by the limits?
Well, as I said, the musical forms had become sort of settled into certain whatever it was, a symphony form or a sonata form and that sort of thing. And he
like
began to
music,
try to. I'm sorry?
Like the structure.
The structure of the piece of music. And if you were an educated musician, you understood these structures, but the average person who didn't know these might find the music very boring, okay? So again, whereas Handel, his pieces tended to be very short, almost like pop songs, okay? Because he wasn't composing for other musicians. He was composing perhaps for the king, who wasn't a musician, or his friends who weren't musicians. So they would be, more pop-oriented in that sense, okay? Hmm. But just in the little bit that I played of you, two other classical composers, this is, again, one of my all-time favorites. This is the second movement of Beethoven's Seventh Symphony. This is where the Mosers go. But you can already hear how different Beethoven is, okay? Yeah, just listen, believe us, it's great.
Yeah.
It keeps getting better.
Go home and listen to Beethoven.
Is that today's assignment?
It's great stuff. Now, I had actually taken a movement from one of his sonatas and I did an analysis of it. I don't have time for this. Okay.
I don't have time for this.
But I thought this would be kind of interesting. This is what I call subtle rebellions, because I think that the classical era did get very boring in a sense, as I said. And people would, go to the concerts and fall asleep. And I could
to give you an idea, I sat through one concert that had a 40-minute cello solo.
Oh,
oh
man.
What was that?
I was exhausted.
It must have been a really deep sleep.
I was don't know how I stayed awake. I was like 10 or something, and I went, and I was like,
Bella. Yeah, you insulted the cellist.
Oh my god, it was 40 now, minutes though. I think you'd be falling asleep.
40
minutes.
40-minute cello. It makes up for the fact that they don't have solos any other rest.
Makes a bass solo sound good.
It's better than a 40-minute drum solo. I'll give it that.
Yeah.
It was inevitable that composers would want to break out of these structures. Okay, and I could show you examples of where they certainly push the limits of tonality. Very. Dissonant type of things, but I have just a couple of somewhat humorous examples of how these guys got sick and tired of being constrained by these structures. This one is Haydn's Surprise Symphony.
Oh, jeez.
Which is a very simple and humorous, but and the second movement of his Surprise Symphony, he got sick and tired of people falling asleep, so he surprised them. Just a segment of it. This next one, I had to edit it, otherwise it would be too long. But it's one of my favorites, where Beethoven just, in the first movement of his Seventh Symphony, he starts out with just a grand Beethoven theme, and it's going along, and everything's fine. And then he just changes his mind. And he says, you know, I don't like this theme. And he's actually, you can actually hear him changing his mind. And he's going, what about this note? This might be better. How about this? He goes, yeah. And he just starts the whole symphony over again. And it's Beethoven. So who the hell is going to argue with me? Right? So I you can hear the opening theme, and then I fade it out, and I fast forward a couple minutes, and then it comes back in with the second theme comes in. But it just, again, sort of breaking the rules. Starts out fine enough. Very straight rhythm.
So even Beethoven got bored of classical music.
Beethoven got bored of Beethoven. Yeah.
Ha ha ha! changing his mind.
Where are we going with this, Ludwig?
Here, here's an idea. This completely starts over again. He never comes back to the original theme. Take it up to where it really comes in before.
Yeah. What reminds he mentioned it sound like Bugs Bunny Looney Tunes kind of thing is one of the most ingenious things done ever in the 20th century period was that they took the Three Little Pigs, Warner Brothers did,
yeah,
and set it to Brahms' Hungarian Dance.
Yeah.
And it works beautifully.
I
miss you. Just look up on YouTube Hungarian. Yeah, just like Looney Tunes Hungarian Dance will probably come up, but this is genius.
So, Steve, we really have an enlightened childhood watching on cartoons at Saturday morning, didn't we?
Had no idea. That pig music.
Wonderful. This comes out genius.
All right, I'm going to try to make quick work of this. Romantic era, 1820 to the 1900.
And that's it.
And that's right. And then the world ends. So this is where they start to really sort of break down these structures.
Oh, we only have 200 years to go.
And it becomes more of a personal expression of the composer. Okay. Also, melody sort of becomes king over form. And then it also in this area, very much nationalistic. You hear a lot of composers like borrowing themes from folk music from their native land and that sort of thing. So I'm not going to play these in full, but just to give you an idea, some of the greatest melodies of classical music comes from this era, this romantic era. This is what, probably pictures at an exhibition, I'm guessing. I'll just play like 10 seconds of each one. Dvorak, he was Czechoslovakian.
He was.
I believe
right now,
so.
Is he Czech or Slovakian?
Good question.
This is the Largo.
It probably was different there at that point.
This is from the New World Symphony. actually, this melody is sometimes used as a funeral song. They've added words to it.
Let's push the Czechs in this.
Edited some of these. They're not necessarily the beginning of this piece of music.
Thank you.
lot of works with the piano, used a lot of folk forms, polkas and mazurkas and various things. This is from Scheherazade.
Oh, speaking of great cartoons, how about the Hippo Ballerinas fanfic?
Yes. Yes.
Holberg Suite.
A horsey song.
Next one, Smetana. This is from a piece called the Moldo, which is a river that runs through Czechoslovakia or the Czech Republic or Slovakia or whatever you want to call it. And I love this composition because it really paints a picture. It's supposed to be the idea of these little rivulets of water in the mountain, and represented by flutes that kind of intermingle, and then they become a brook. And they become a stream, and they go down the mountain, and they empty out into the Moldo. And when you hear the great Moldo theme, you know you're in the river. So, absolutely beautiful. Sense of melody. I mean, they just had it all together. Tchaikovsky one of the greatest composers, certainly of the Romantic era. He did like a lot of ballets, we know, like the Nutcracker Suite and Romeo and Juliet, Swan Lake, all that sort of thing. But this is actually one of his pieces that's probably not as well known. This is Serenade for Strings. I like it. It's a little more manly than his other ones. Impressionist era.
No! Don't do it!
He has to.
No!
Impressionist
How much
era.
Do I have to go with this joke?
This is really where form was really jettisoned entirely. And mood of actually the tonality, the harmony actually eclipsed melody. And it was really an emphasis on the mood of the music as opposed to like a great melody like you just heard with all of those Romantic era. Break from traditional scales. This is kind of interesting. I had a conversation once with Kevin Rhodes, who was the conductor of the Springfield Symphony. He did some workshops at the community music school, and I talked to him there a bit. Then we exchanged emails and we had some conversations. What? Anyway, he was of the mind that what really completely changed music was the use of this whole tone scale. What's the whole tone scale? Okay, well, we saw all those formulas with half steps and whole steps and so forth. Whole tone scale simply means it's all whole steps. And usually you hear this like when Gilligan gets hit on the head with a coconut. Right? Right? And it kind of gives you this sense that he's like floating in air, okay? And that's because there's no half steps. There's no sense of tonic, okay? It's just... Right? And the Impressionists used this a lot.
Oh, no.
And he was convinced...
Now, if I may ask a question.
Yeah.
There's no half steps in the early pagan music either.
Right.
So what's the difference, I guess?
Well, this why do you get
more of that...
Floaty.
Floaty, you know,
because
sort of sense
every
with this.
Because every single note is exactly equal distant from the one next to it. Now in the pagan, it might have had a whole step, a minor third, and then a whole step, and then another minor third. So you did have some variance, which did give you at least some sense of tonic, even with pagan music.
Okay.
Now with the whole step, the whole tone scale, where does it begin? Where does it end? There's no sense of any kind of tonic, okay?
Yep.
Okay, so he was convinced that this is really where we led to sort of 20th century music here, was this breakdown of the scale. And I disagreed with him. I think he was kind of sort of right in the sense that it broke from this all-important scale. But try as they might, even the Impressionists composers couldn't really write entire pieces using a whole tone scale. And they kind of settled on using it just as an occasional device to get your attention. It's and I'll give you an example. If you know, speaking of Stevie Wonder, the song "You Are the Sunshine of My Life," right? And it begins. That's a whole tone scale, right? He does it twice at the beginning and never comes back to it. It's just a way of it grabbing your attention. And that's pretty much how the Impressionists used this whole tone scale. I don't think it was quite as revolutionary as Maestro Rhodes seems to think it is, okay? But whatever. I think the what really makes the Impressionist era different is the use of the major seventh on the tonic. Now, what the hell am I talking about here?
Well, everybody knows that.
Well, all right, what is a seventh chord? All right. If you, the most basic form of harmony is two notes. Most basic chord would be a triad, that's three notes, where you start on whatever your bass note is, you go up three, and then you go up another three. It's a triad. If I go up another three, that becomes what they call a seventh chord. Seven. Okay, but I can do that on any great seventh chords. Okay, anybody following this? Okay. Now, typically, in every era that came before this, they would have avoided seventh chords on the tonic because you're coming home again. You have this triumphant return to the tonic. But in the Impressionist era, began to use the major seventh, that seventh, with the tonic. And it kind of created this melancholy kind of sound. Why? Well, in my opinion, it's because it actually incorporates that all-important leading tone leads you back to the tonic in the chord itself. So you simultaneously...
That's a half step
from the tonic. So you simultaneously have a sense that you're at home and longing to be home at the same time. That's really what revolutionized the Impressionist composition, is the heavy use of that major seventh, which actually has that sense of longing for home. That you never really quite get home. You feel like you're there, but you're not. What?
Orange.
So now, I also have here misclassification and misnomer. They called it the Impressionist era because Impressionist art was popular at that time. And if you recall from my talk on Impressionist art, remember? Where they kind of took a step back from super realism, okay, but it was still realist art, okay. The Impressionist composers hated the term Impressionism as related to music. Really, the better example would be the Pre-Raphaelites, and if you recall in my discussion on art, I talked about one of the warning signs of the 20th century was the rise of the melancholy. And that happened in art as well as in music. And you can see some of the very beautiful art that was made just leading up to the 20th century, but all of it is sort of tinged with a sense of melancholy. And this is really, if you want a visual representation of what was happening during the Impressionist era in music, it's really a better match with Pre-Raphaelite art than it is with this, which tends to be very happy stuff. And Impressionist music is not really happy. It has this kind of melancholy quality to it. So I'm going to play some of this. Debussy, he starts this with a whole tone scale. This is Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun, famous piece. Thank you. great impressionist.
Clayton.
And he did Bolero, yeah. I'm tempted to play this one. This is about 3 minutes in length. It's just so beautiful. Music educators, music books will tell you that this was the precursor of all of the atonal music that was to come in the 20th century. That's absolute nonsense. This is obviously an extension of Romanticism. This is like Romanticism on steroids. I can't think of any music that's more romantic than the Impressionist era. It clearly is hyper-Romanticism. So that's a myth that was made up after the fact, after atonal music came. They sort of tried to make it seem like it was a natural evolution. It wasn't a natural evolution. Fauré, this is from his Requiem Mass. Can you hear the sort of melancholy quality to it? Listen to too much of this stuff because it just will bring you down in a sense.
It's like music to throw yourself off a bridge to.
Yeah. it's just very sad stuff, but very beautiful. I mean, it kind of reminds me. I remember seeing Father Groeschel on some show and he had written a book about mystics, and he used a phrase that I'll never forget. That he had these different levels of mystics, you know, getting further and further out there. You know? And the ones that were really out there, he says, these people were walking on very high cliffs. And I'll never forget that phrase, walking, because it gives you the sense that they're very close to God, but at the same time they could fall off and die in a moment, you know. And that's kind of what this music reminds me of. It's just like it's ethereal. It's just out there. This is Daphne and Chloe. You can hear how a lot of movie soundtracks were copied after this. This is wild stuff. It's no longer a melody. It's just you're caught up in the rapture of this.
real danger of it.
Yes.
Like, you were talking, like, about how in the pagan era it was, like, an emphasis on rhythm, and then it sort of became melody. Would you say that this is sort of, like,
where... Harmony.
Harmony came?
Harmony becomes king. That's exactly right. Where melody, it's there, but it's now taken a back seat, in a sense. That's exactly right. Okay? Now... I've got another quote by a English writer, which I just found not long ago. I love this quote. The aim of art is to please. What a simple and profound thought, okay? Art is supposed to please people, okay? And everything you've heard up to now, that is the purpose of it, whether they were trying to please the church, or whether they were trying to please the king, or whether they were trying to please the academy, or whatever they were trying to please somebody. Until...
until this guy. Over. This animal.
20th century.
His name.
Rebellion against the past. Desire to shock, insult, ridicule, not please. Break from traditional scales, break from consonants. I remember when I gave the lecture on art, I have a recording of that, and I remember you said that it really all... boil down to World War One. Have you made that comment?
I think so.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and I've been reading a lot. I just read a book, 1917, where it talks about the apparitions at Fatima and the beginning of the Russian Revolution, how everything was happening in that time. And really, this is what happened in the arts. There was actually, as Marius told me many times, this Dadaist movement, which was really where a deliberate attempt to use art as a battering ram to destroy Western civilization. There was no ifs, ands, or buts about it. So anyone who tells you that what comes next is a natural evolution of music, that's a lie. Just as in art, this was a total breakdown. This was a horrible aberration. And I think it was a lot of things that led up to it. As we've said before, the French Revolution and the Enlightenment, so to speak, and theory of evolution, all of these things were like acid eating away. But I think it really all culminated with World War One, which, as the Pope at the time, what was that, Pope Benedict the 15th, yeah, who said it was Europe committing suicide. And even the... even though I think it was Napoleon had disbanded the Holy Roman Empire in 1806, it still really kind of went on culturally because you still had the Habsburgs ruling, and they ruled over a great deal. But this is where it ended. This was when culturally the Holy Roman Empire ended. And I think there had always been people waiting in the wings, waiting for Christianity to stumble. And this was their moment. And they rushed in, and they kicked the crap out of us, is basically what happened. And it was reflected in everything, in education, and in art, and certainly in music. So, which brings us to...
No! Notice he doesn't look too happy.
The Curious Case of Arnold Schoenberg. Now, I could pick any number of atonal 20th century composers, but I pick Schoenberg, number one, because he is considered the father of atonal music, but also because even his life is kind of like a metaphor for what happened. He actually converted to Catholicism, and he was a Catholic convert. You look at when he was born, towards the end of the 1800s, early 1900s, he was actually composing music that was tonal. It may have been, you know, very advanced, like you would probably say post-romanticism, somewhat impressionist. I'll play some of that for you. This is his most popular piece. Not by any means great, but it's tonal. It's not too much different from what we were just listening to. Anyway, by the time of World War I or so, he gave up Christianity, and which, in a sense, as I said, is kind of a metaphor of what happened to so much of Western civilization at that time. And he set out, literally, to dismantle, aggressively, consciously, knowingly, to dismantle this tonal system which had taken centuries to put together. Okay? And part of it was because he bought into this relativistic notion that the only reason we liked Beethoven, the only reason we liked Ravel, was because we'd been told to. And that he really believed that he could just create a whole new system, and that in time we would all learn to love that, like a dog vomiting. We would just all, if we were told that a dog vomiting sounded good, we would think it sounded good. This is nonsense, okay? Everything that came before this proves that it's nonsense, right? But just to give you, I don't want to get into too much technicality, this is, was what he came up with. All 12 notes equal. So now, remember, an octave is divided to these 12 notes, right? Now you're not going to have a sense anymore that one note is any more important than the other, which was what, right? Now any one of them is just as important as any other note. So it obliterates the whole concept of tonic. The whole idea of coming home again is gone, okay? Use of tone rows. What this means is that you would create a melody using a certain number of notes, right? And then you would play those notes forwards, and you could play them backwards, you can play them upside down, okay? So there was a sort of a pattern or a science to it. No sense of key, no sense of tonic, emancipation of the dissonance. Now, what he meant by that was that, unlike, remember, the, it's almost the exact opposite of paganism. Paganism was an avoidance of dissonance. Christian music used dissonance as a powerful medium to bring you back to consonance. Now, dissonance was essentially king for this guy. In other words, that's all there was dissonance with him, okay? A completely different way of looking at it. Now, just to give you an idea of the magnitude of this guy's ego, yeah. I have made, this is some quotes from him directly, "I have made a discovery which will ensure the supremacy of German music for the next 100 years.
Thank God that didn't happen.
He was still in that romantic mentality of being very nationalistic. At that time, he was thinking of it as Germany, you know, sort of dominating the whole musical world. In 10 years, every talented composer will be writing this way."
He's reading Hegel.
Yeah, seriously.
Right.
His name means beautiful mountain.
Don't do this.
No, we have all of
them.
Why?
What are you thinking?
I'm leaving right now if you do.
Lecture's over.
Oh my gosh.
I'll be kind. Now, you know, and we've heard a lot of this stuff, like in scary movies and stuff.
But
you have to imagine people never having heard this before, and they pay money and go to a concert, and this is what they hear.
Is that where the pianist kills over?
It's over! Thank God!
It's the best
part. Where the dog throws up.
All right, let's see.
Well, like, that's kind of my thing with soundtracks to things, is if it works with the concept it's trying to convey,
right,
then it works. That's perfect for like being on like some alien world
right.
where nothing makes sense. Where there's like mushroom people walking on the sun.
Music for mushrooms.
Yeah.
Here's some with
people
voices.
On mushrooms.
I'm gonna step on that mushroom, man.
Is this Alban Berg?
What's that?
Alban Berg.
No, this is still Schoenberg. I do have an example.
Oh,
no. You can clearly see that beautiful rhapsodic music that we just heard was not a precursor to this. It has no relationship whatsoever. That's a big lie and myth. This is not a natural progression.
Okay.
It's deliberately ugly.
It's deliberately ugly.
Don't do Alvin Berg. Don't you dare.
Okay, I won't do Berg. I had some Weaver and some Berg in here. They were students of his. Imagine this didn't go over too well. And there was a number of concerts where fist fights literally broke out. Now, and they had to call the police. Now, you stop and think about it. That's because people knew that this wasn't a natural evolution of music. People knew that this was a deliberate insult. It would be like going in to the Louvre and urinating on the Mona Lisa. They knew what this was. And fistfights broke out. People were insulted. They were intended to be insulted. They knew they were insulted, and they didn't like being insulted.
Were they punching musicians?
They were punching, people in the audience who were trying to stick up for this.
No. I would like it if someone punched Schoenberg.
Oh, you wouldn't have lived.
Now, here's some samples of how the press people were reacting to it. As I was leaving the state opera, I had the sensation of having been not in a public theater, but in an insane asylum. On the stage, in the orchestra, in the stalls, plain madmen. We deal here, from a musical viewpoint, a capital offense.
Thank you. Oh, here's some.
And this one is interesting. This is actually in a communist newspaper. Berg's opera reveals the helplessness of the Western European petty bourgeois intelligentsia before the oncoming fascistization, and demonstrates the crisis not only in the individual consciousness of the Western European bourgeois composer, but in Western European musical culture in general. Well, the only time I agree with a communist.
That's funny.
Now, again, just
know what Jopper he was talking about?
I don't know. I'm not really sure.
Helplessness.
And this was Schoenberg's defiant response to all this kind of criticism. I believe what I do and do only what I believe, and woe to anybody who lays hands on my faith. Such a man I regard as an enemy. You cannot be with me if you are also with my opponents.
There is an
obvious reference to the words of Christ. He obviously had a messianic kind of vision of himself, and his views divergent from my own are something I should never resent, as little as I resent anyone's having any other disability. Oh, short leg, a clumsy hand. Oh. I could only be sorry for such a person.
Oh,
so if you don't like it, it's because there's something wrong with you. Okay, and I refused to pay money to download this stuff. I actually went on YouTube and just took the thing out and plugged it into my CD recorder, because I wasn't going to spend money on this. But I read some of the comments that people had made about this music, and it was things like, well, you just don't understand it, people just aren't educated enough. Well, I do understand it. I am educated about this. I understand the concept of serialism. I understand the concept of retrograde and inversion retrograde and tone rows. I get it. I do know it. It still sucks. Okay? It has nothing to do with it. It just doesn't sound good, all right? So here's some obvious criticisms, okay? The one thing that everybody seems to miss, remember the tuning system, which was the one big, giant, subjective event in music history where we changed it to a 12-tone tuning system. His entire, he prided himself on thinking that he was freeing himself from all the rules of the past, if you know what I'm saying. And so that he wanted pure music that was not in any way infected by previous concepts of what sounded good. But his whole system was a 12-tone system. Well, where did he get these 12 tones? It was based upon that compromise tuning system, which was one of the biggest subjective human changes in music history, which I think is kind of ironic. The other thing that no one seems to pick up on is this is obviously based upon politics. What was the up-and-coming popular political movement? It was communism and socialism, which means everybody's equal, right?
Every tone is equal.
Every tone is equal. So in the traditional system, if I'm in C, guess who the king is? C. The chord that leads most strongly to it would be the dominant of fifth away. It's like the queen, if you will, okay? Or if you think of chess, or the other major chord would be the fourth chord. If you want to think of it as the prince, okay? But they all lead back to the king. Have a series of the minor chords, which are considered substitutes for the major chords. So there's a hierarchical structure to our whole tonal system. By saying that this note is just as important as this note, right?
Excellent.
It's based upon, it's an expression, I think it's an obvious expression of this, this revolution of communist thinking, okay? So you can actually hear what communism sounds like.
Oh, we've seen what communism is. I mean, I've seen communist buildings.
It's so ugly, man.
System is a personal, subjective invention. This is kind of similar to the first one, except that it's his personal, subjective invention. You know, the more I thought about this, how absolutely ridiculous this is. Our entire tonal system took centuries and centuries and centuries to sort of come together. It wasn't one guy, okay? It was many, many musicians, thousands of musicians over hundreds of years playing their music for millions of people. And this one guy was going to come up with this one idea, and we're all supposed to follow him like puppy dogs? I mean, it really is ridiculous, okay? The next obvious criticism is it sounds bad.
There's not much else to say there.
No variety of mood, no matter who composes in this system. It all sounds... If they could do it today, if they do it 10 years ago, if they do it 10 years from now, there's no variety of mood. Think about that. Think of all the different kinds of songs, whether they're pop songs that you like or classical songs. Some are sad, some are happy, some are triumphant, some are melancholy and reflective. This is all this sick to your stomach kind of mood.
Like
every
dog.
Single one of them.
It really is.
It has no potential, you know, beyond that. Okay.
I'll listen to Lady Gaga over this any day.
She does have variety going on. Yeah. Like interesting. She operates in scales vaguely.
And because there's no tonic, there, of course, is no sense of satisfaction. Like you say, it you're out lost in space. It's not even like you're lost at sea, where at least you know where up is and where you know where down is. You're lost in space.
Twilight Zone.
You lost another dimension as far as that.
You don't have any sense of tonic, so you have no sense of home. You have no sense of up. You have no sense of down. It really is a horrifying kind of music. Now... I'm almost done here. I have a photograph of Arnold Schoenberg's tombstone.
What is it, a cardboard box?
And I don't mean to make fun of the dead, but a tombstone is a piece of art, so it's worth analyzing for me.
No.
And I think it's very indicative.
I've laughed every time I've seen John Hancock's tombstone.
Seriously?
Yep.
Look, there you go. There you go. That's everything you need to know.
That's everything you need to know.
That's all you need to know about Schoenberg.
And to me, it's you know, an ice cube, and it's balanced on one edge, which an ice cube can't do.
Have his urge to tip it over.
Right. And the only reason it can stand is because it's being artificially propped up. And that's the only reason his music has been able to stand all these years, is because it's artificially propped up. average people don't buy this. Average people don't like this. This is a ruse. This is nonsense. Okay, it's about time people just start saying that. They're still teaching this nonsense in schools today. But even Schoenberg, towards the end, started to get more tonal because he
couldn't take it anymore.
And no one was buying his stuff, you know? What's up?
Tired of throwing up every night.
That point of everything being artificially propped up, that was pretty much most of the 20th century from the sounds of it, most of the ideals that came about in the 20th century.
At least in art.
I was speaking just even politically, we're all artificially propped up. You get guys like Pol Pot, who's like, everyone's going to be a farmer. Well, not everyone can be a farmer, so half the country starved to death. And the result of it is, after it collapses, and you look at Eastern Europe, and it brings tears to my eyes. You get places like Hungary and Austria. They're all just nihilism and pornography nowadays.
Yeah.
There's like nothing else to it. You look at Vienna, it's like organized crime and stuff. You're shocked that anyone could have composed there. It ends up artificially propping itself up over like the broken bones of everything before.
Yeah.
Then just collapses because the ground isn't even.
Yeah. All right, I'm almost done, believe it or not. I had to give some examples of other composers in the 20th century who were composing good music. Just take my word for it.
Oh, they were great.
Now, as I did with the discussion on art, I do have some predictions about the future. And the problem, as with art and so many things, the academy became the patron eventually. And so people started making art to please these intellectual snobs, rather than trying to please the people, it was to please the intellectual snobs. And this is what happens, and this is what happened. I think that, and right now, in conservatories, people are either trying to mimic Schoenberg, or...
My face exactly.
Or they're trying to revive the past, like doing a new romanticism. The problem is, they don't feel it culturally. It's the same problem that they have in the visual arts. It's not part of who they are anymore. And so it ends up, the new kind of romantic music sounds very syrupy to me. It just doesn't have the kind of depth to it that the original romantics have. I think the great classical music today is where you wouldn't expect it. Like so many things, like I used to... when I was a kid, I had a Star Trek shirt and a Star Trek poster. Never threw them all away, never knowing that they would be valuable someday. That's the way things always are. It's the things you don't expect that become valuable. I think the great class, 100 years from now, they'll look back and movie soundtracks are going to be the great classical music. Mm. What
happened when I was painting and I had that soundtrack going, you walk in, you go, oh, what's this?
Yeah.
What's
John this Williams is going to be like, be John known Powell. As the great composer of the last
I hope
of the 20th century.
I certainly
hope
better than Schoenberg.
Better than Schoenberg, though.
Not quite as good as Lady Gaga. No.
Imagine if they'd done Star Wars with Schoenberg.
It just would have been the cantina
it
scene
wouldn't
the whole
worked.
Time.
And I think part of the reason is because who are they trying to please? They're trying to please the common man, first of all. But also because they're stepping out of themselves. They're actually writing about something other than just trying to aggrandize themselves. They have an agenda, you know, in terms of something outside themselves. Here's a movie, I have to do this. And that's allows them to really create art without being so self-conscious. And that's the death of any art, is that it becomes self-conscious. So I have just one sample here. This is from the soundtrack of the movie Glory. I don't know if any of you have seen that.
Movie.
Fantastic movie, which is about the 54th Regiment, the Black Regiment that fought in the Civil War. And some of them are actually buried over at Oak Grove Cemetery, by the way. But it's great because it has these wonderful tonal melodies. But because it's a movie about war, he then combines these tonal melodies and it becomes kind of this dissonant cacophony. But it works because of the theme of what he's writing about. challenging stuff, but you know, he's got a lot of melodic stuff. So, this is my last line. And I tried to think how I should end this, but if you're familiar with the
good place to stop.
The Beatles.
Oh, there's a circle.
Yeah, I know.
All the way back.
No, it's a drum. The Beatles' Sgt. Pepper album has all these various faces up here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This guy, his name was Stockhausen, Karl Heinz Stockhausen, a German modern composer who wrote stuff like this. So he was that kind of composer. Plus, he did a lot of things. If you've heard the Beatles' Revolution Number 9, you know, Number 9, Number 9, you know, that horrible thing that they did with the piecing together. He did a lot of that where he pieced together tapes.
This is why you were playing the White Album before the Chester
Bennington
started.
Oh, man. Well, they admired him to some degree, I guess. And of course, their producer, George Martin, was classically trained. He did all the string arrangements for things like Eleanor Rigby and that sort of thing, so it's understandable that they would have known of this guy, and they clearly copied him with Revolution Number 9. And they experimented. You know, the Beatles were always pushing the envelope. They were very pop, but they were always trying something different, whether it was Indian music and that kind of thing. And their first real foray into atonality was in The Day in a Life, which is on this album, and I've edited it here, so picking up halfway through. And what I like about this is that it descends into this atonal cacophony at the end of the song, and it just gets louder and more crazy. But then it stops, and it finishes with a final major chord. And it just, to me, it summarizes so much of Western civilization that we can push the limits, but I think the desire for home is so strong that we can't abandon it. We don't abandon it. And it's just a nice, as I said, kind of a metaphor for that. So I'll just play the end of that. I'm tempted to play the whole thing. It's such a great tune.
Beatles.
We'll come out.
For that 4-hour and
I really like
3 hours, 45 minutes.
I learned a lot though.
Would watch again.
That was really good, Steve. You should invite it to two talks though.
Yeah, yeah.